We begin our look back at Bill's illustrious career with us. This is his final story for Fox 8.
Yes, thank you, Jennifer. F. Lee Bailey is what the story is about. He represented two of the most notorious murder suspects in American history. First, he defended Cleveland's own Sam Shepard and later O.J. Simpson. Both cases reached the same verdict. But for Bailey personally, the outcomes were very different. In a sense, Cleveland is his adopted hometown.
Cleveland is a city without which you wouldn't have ever heard my name.
Because?
Dr. Sam Shepard was considered an impossible case.
An impossible case that a young F. Lee Bailey won in 1966, first winning a new trial for Shepard at the U.S. Supreme Court, and then winning him an acquittal at his second trial.
Did you intend to yell not guilty quite that loud, Sam?
I've yelled it ever since I was arrested.
Sam Shepard spent 10 years in prison, convicted in 1954 of brutally killing his wife Marilyn in a bedroom of their Lakeside Bay Village home. Shepard always said the real killer was what he called the one-armed man, who he had struggled with after the murder along the beach behind his home on Lake Erie.
And you're convinced that what Sam said happened on this beach is what happened on this beach?
I would bet my life on it.
When Bailey won Shepard an acquittal in 1966, his legal skills were the subject of high praise. A generation later, in 1995, a different case, the same verdict.
Not guilty of the crime of murder.
But for F. Lee Bailey, a different reality.
I have suffered, frankly, a great deal as the culprit in the O.J. case.
Bailey was one of a group of lawyers known as the Dream Team that won an acquittal for O.J. Simpson. Like Shepard, the Simpson case was called the Trial of the Century. Simpson was an NFL Hall of Fame running back who'd been accused of brutally murdering his ex-wife Nicole and her friend Ron Goldman. This time, though, the reaction to F. Lee Bailey's legal skills was quite different.
I have had lawyers who were quite rude to me about prostituting my talents for a guilty man, and they usually had another word other than man.
While different in many ways, the Shepard and Simpson cases have unquestionable parallels. Both involved well-off men accused of savage murders of a wife or an ex-wife, and both cases had star prosecution witnesses with deep flaws that Bailey exposed. In the Shepard case, it was Cuyahoga County Coroner Sam Gerber, who sounded confident ahead of the second trial before he faced Bailey in a Cleveland courtroom.
We have the same evidence as we had before. We have the same people available, and we can go to trial tomorrow.
Gerber had testified at Shepard's first trial that the murder weapon was a surgical instrument whose image he saw impressed in a pillow. But he never produced one, and at the second trial, Bailey got him to admit that in the 12 years since the first trial, he'd never found an instrument to match that bloody impression. Under oath on the stand, Gerber was forced to confess, quote, "I hunted all over the United States, and I couldn't find one."
He lied?
He lied. When he said that's a surgical instrument, he had no picture in his mind of any surgical instrument.
Lying was key in the Simpson case as well. Bailey confronted Detective Mark Furman, who found a bloody glove at Simpson's home that was connected to the murders. Bailey's questions focused on whether Furman was lying about being biased, whether he'd called African Americans by the N-word.
So that anyone who comes to this court and quotes you as using that word in dealing with African Americans would be a liar, would they not, Detective Furman?
Yes, they would.
All of them, correct?
All of them.
Bailey had witnesses lined up, but before it came time to call them, a defense investigator found tapes of Furman using the N-word repeatedly. The defense theory was that Furman planted the bloody glove to implicate Simpson. After being caught in the N-word lie, Furman repeatedly pled the Fifth Amendment.
I only have one other question.
What was that, Mr. Furman?
Detective Furman, did you plant or manufacture any evidence in this case?
I assert my Fifth Amendment privilege.
That's the case?
He does not deny planting the glove. You can't take the Fifth Amendment unless the answer will hurt you. How would a no answer have hurt him?
There was evidence pointing towards Simpson's guilt, as there was in the Shepard case. But Bailey's cross-examinations helped create reasonable doubt in both cases. And in the Simpson case, another key dramatic moment was when the defendant tried on the glove and apparently had trouble making it fit. Bailey says he had baited prosecutor Christopher Darden.
Chris, take a look at that glove. I know it won't fit O.J., and you know it won't fit O.J., and I'm going to ask him to try it on. And he said, no, I will. And he did. And he
would you have had O.J. try it on?
Try it on?
Yeah.
If I was the prosecutor? Oh, yeah. My Lord, no.
That moment led to defense attorney Johnny Cochran's famous closing argument.
If it doesn't fit, you must acquit.
The jury did find O.J. Simpson not guilty, a famous photo capturing the moment that the verdict was read. The Shepard case here in Cleveland and the Simpson case in Los Angeles are really the bookends of the heart of F. Lee Bailey's career. But after Simpson, he found trouble. It's complicated, but he had a case involving a drug dealer where he said some stock was his fee, and the government said it was supposed to be turned over to them. A judge agreed with the government, and F. Lee Bailey went to jail for a little while, wound up getting disbarred and owing a huge tax bill.
Do you think some of the issues you've had with the Bar Association, the tax issues, do you think they're at least indirectly tied back to the O.J. case?
No. I think they are directly tied. The causation chain is clear. You got him off as if it were a bad sin committed on my part. I mean, after all, even if he was guilty, my job was to raise a reasonable doubt.
At 87, Bailey is still active, apparently not bitter, and appears upbeat. He loves being who he is and who he has been. Love him or loathe him, F. Lee Bailey is grateful for his career and knows that some see him as a villain and others as a hero. And looking back now on the career that took off for him here in Cleveland, he rejects both.
I think that the best legacy I could leave, and the one I would like to have inscribed, is he always chased for the truth.